Hi, I'm Fox San Antonio's Jessica Headley.
And I'm Ryan Wolf.
Our greatest responsibility is to serve our Treasure Valley communities.
The El Paso, Las Cruces communities.
Eastern Iowa communities.
Mid-Michigan communities.
We are extremely proud of the quality, balanced journalism that CBS 4 News produces.
But
we are concerned about trouble and trying to be responsible, one-sided news stories plaguing our country.
The sharing of biased and false news has become all too common on social media. More alarming, some media outlets publish the same fake stories without checking facts first.
The sharing of biased and
false news has become all too common on social media.
This is extremely dangerous to our democracy.
Often cited as the founder of modern journalism, Walter Lippmann, in his famous work The Public Opinion, had argued that people are too easily swayed by misinformation, and the increased power of propaganda of the governing class had rendered the traditional democratic governance. Although Lippmann recognized the media's role in agenda setting and distortion of reality, ultimately had advocated for a technocratic top-down media elites who filtered the right information for us and rejected the notion that people could instead govern themselves, arguing for the engineering of consent by the elite journalists upon the people. In the famous essay The Basic Problem of Democracy, which is in relation to the question of the media, he argued for a wise censorship and viewed liberty differently than, let's say, John Stuart Mill, while exposing him as a hypocrite. Let me quote his reasoning. "There are, so far as I can discover, no absolutists of liberty. I can recall no doctrine of liberty which, under the acid test, does not become contingent upon some other ideal. The goal is never liberty, but liberty for something or other. For liberty is a condition under which activity takes place, and men's interests attach themselves primarily to their activities and what is necessary to fulfill them, not to the abstract requirement of any activity that might be conceived." His views were soon challenged by John Dewey, a contemporary public figure and a philosopher, culminating in the Lippmann-Dewey debate, in which John Dewey had advocated for a more democratic bottom-up journalism as opposed to a top-down elite-driven approach advocated by Walter Lippmann. The debate had occurred at around the same time when the old WASP elite was displaced by a new cosmopolitan elite, and this debate could essentially be seen as a part of the larger story that is masked under the battle of ideas. And much as the white Anglo-Saxons had lost control in the second half of the 20th century over the country, so did John Dewey's approach to journalism was discredited and the ideas of Walter Lippmann took the upper hand, subsequently being continued by Edward Bernays, a person better known as the father of propaganda, who went as far as to influence Joseph Goebbels. In effect, he developed a synthesized application towards controlling and manipulating the crowd, employing the tactics of his uncle Freud and Gustave Le Bon, largely treating people as cattle that could be shaped as one pleases. Though mostly focusing on advertisement, his ideas about engineering consent were proven to be of great utility. In the book Propaganda, he writes, "The conscious and intelligent manipulation of the organized habits and opinions of the masses is an important element in a democratic society. Those who manipulate this unseen mechanism of society constitute an invisible government, which is the true ruling power of our country. We are governed, our minds are molded, our tastes are formed, our ideas suggested, largely by men we have never heard of. This is a logical result of the way in which our democratic society is organized. Vast numbers of human beings must cooperate in this manner if they are to live together. together as a smoothly functioning society. In almost every act of our daily lives, whether in the sphere of politics or business, in our social conduct or in our ethical thinking, we are dominated by the relatively small number of persons who understand the mental processes and social patterns of the masses. It is they who pull the wires which control the public mind. This is probably a good way to start this episode in the series of how institutions shape society, how exactly they manipulate and lie to you, pushing a leftist agenda, and how we can take it back. The first part will talk about the media-industrial complex, the second part will talk about the education system. The rest for now is undecided, but I have a lot of material for proving that the left is the system, my own personal experiences in the university, and proving a widespread right-wing discrimination that exists in our system that also plays a role in the leftist cultural hegemony. So yeah, this is just the first episode, which will focus largely on the media, first showing multiple examples of media lies, why it lies, and how it lies with a proposed model. Also, if you like this video, I ask you to donate to my Patreon and Subscribestar. The links will be provided in the description below, and soon enough there will be exclusive content there, so stay tuned. Anyhow, when I first read the public opinion, and even now, I'm somewhat sympathetic to that kind of an idea, not just because he argued it well, but also because egalitarianism is kinda cringe. However, at the same time, I happen to think that the job of a journalist is to report information as accurately as possible and to more or less represent the views of the people over which they broadcast, not to sell a subjective narrative of the ruling class. And in this video, I will show exactly how poorly our media system works, how out of touch with reality it is, how instead of representing our interests, it pushes false narratives into us, lies to us. Us and molds us just as Walter Lippmann and Edward Bernays had wanted. A lot of people had gotten recently red-pilled about the media during the Kyle Rittenhouse trials. I remember getting red-pilled much earlier and by the portrayal of Donald Trump during his presidential campaign and during his presidency, marking 2016 as the year when I started paying attention to Western politics. At that time, you could say that Trump's coverage was only 9% positive, which is the first time I have begun structurally wondering about who shapes America. Now, things have gotten so out of hand that the bias is right in front of your eyes, and even some leftists have to admit that we live in the media-driven consensus. Before I'll elaborate further, I will give a couple of more examples. The January 6th, whatever you wanna call it, was truly a chaotic and shameful event in US history, driven by false conspiracy theories and ego. However, the narrative that is pushed upon us with regards to it is false. The narrative is that Republicans are a danger to democracy because about 50% of Republicans believe that the election was stolen and the Capitol storm. Now, for the disclaimer, all that is said here is true. The facts are correct. The problem is the framing of this narrative and the subsequent endless reinforcement of this message. First off, there was just one guy with a Confederate flag in the building, yet apparently instead of this being framed as a QAnon shaman gathering and MAGA-tard freak show, apparently if you listen to the media, it was a white supremacist insurrection, all because of that one guy with a flag. Maybe Nick Fuentes also had something to do with it, I don't know, but all major white nationalists had essentially denounced it. Anyways, that's not even my main point. Now, if you remember the results of the 2016 election and how the establishment acted as if Trump was an illegitimate president who stole the election with the help of Russia and weighed it against the current narrative, it turns out you can't push the firmer narrative of Republicans hating democracy and being conspiracy theorists any longer. But yet the narrative is so powerful that when I googled how many Democrats think that the election was stolen, all I got was the narrative about how Republicans don't accept democracy and consequently it's under attack and we must mobilize our resources to stop Republicans from doing anything. But if I were to go back in time and further examine the validity of this narrative, it not just breaks out on itself, but you are even forced to adopt a counter-narrative. In fact, most of millennial Americans thought that Trump was an illegitimate president even a few years ago. Similarly, the media had spent 2 years pushing the Russian collusion conspiracy theory, which had convinced over 80% of Democrats that Trump had won the election unfairly and basically is an illegitimate president. Hell, even after the Mueller report, about half of all Americans, not just Democrats, think that Trump colluded with Russia, despite this being a disproven conspiracy theory. Still, 84% of Democrats were mobilized to remove Trump from the presidency, despite having no grounds for it. But if you Google about it, the results that come up are of a different narrative, in fact, a counterfactual narrative. But if the Republicans had essentially controlled the media, you'd think that Democrats are a threat to democracy, and you'd never forget about these statistics that I just cited to you, and moreover, you'd never pay any attention to the Capitol storm of the January 6th, and likely it would be framed as patriots trying to save democracy. But now, let's go back to that narrative. And it strikes too similar with other narratives which shape the governed population. Consider the narratives about the systemic racism that is supposedly experienced by BIPOCs uniquely. A leftist narrative that had accused Kyle Rittenhouse of white supremacy and made it all about race, including the sitting president, despite Kyle Rittenhouse supporting BLM and shooting three white ex-convicts, one of which had screamed the N-word while trying to kill him, yet he is still regarded as a white supremacist vigilante, according to the most respectable media and our tube-produced intellectuals. Apparently, if you listen to them, whites can go run around killing BIPOCs and there's nothing that the law can do to stop it. And you'd assume that they care so much about race, but you'd be surprised, because when a heavily melanated man went on a rampage white people as a revenge for the Kyle Rittenhouse trial, it was claimed to be an accident. The best they could do is to put intentionally in quotations, and the police subsequently did not consider this to be an act of terrorism or an act of black supremacy. Nonetheless, despite having many evidence to say it was a racially motivated hate crime gathered mostly through social media. Moreover, this was unfortunately ignored even by the conservative media, and was forgotten about the next day. But think of what a story it could have been, and to what extent it would shape the public opinion regarding blacks and the problems of black nationalism or white hatred, if it had received all the negative coverage that Kyle Rittenhouse had received. This in a way reminds me of the hillbilly elegy, and how our entire managerial class had freaked out at the slight possibility that white people may be humans too. Similarly, was played the black violence against Asian Americans, which was blamed on whites. But these are just small examples. Let's look at the larger picture of the structural racism that exists within our media system. In the past years, if we were to combine all the articles in our press that had covered the plight of top 10 most talked about white victims, we would get somewhere between 5 and 6,000 articles. While the amount of articles about blacks being victims is about 260,000, which is to say that our system spends 52 times more talking about blacks and inventing this white supremacy narrative, but when a white man or a white woman is victimized, they are simply being ignored, even if it is done on a systemic level. And they used to be ignored, now they are just mugged with white tears, and apparently that is driving attention from the real deal, which is basically BIPOCs. But if I were to adjust that number to per capita, it will be around 260 times more obsessing over blacks than whites, and if you have an IQ of above 90, you would know that this is an example of a structural racism, because there is no other word to describe it. Instead of talking about white problems, our media is busy spending their time writing articles calling for the deconstruction of whiteness and saying certain things are white supremacist. Here's a small compilation from the top prestigious journal The Scientific American, where the term Jedi is problematic for describing programs that promote justice, equity, diversity and inclusion. If you read the article, apparently because Star Wars is associated with white people. Here's another one, Modern Mathematics confronts its white patriarchal past. If you need more, here's my favorite one. Denial of evolution is a form of white supremacy. Let me quote you their reasoning. I want to unmask the lie that evolution denial is about religion and recognize that at its core it's a form of white supremacy that perpetrates segregation and violence against black bodies. Under the guise of religious freedom, the legalistic wing of creationists loudly insist that their point of view deserves equal time in the classroom. Science education in the United States is constantly on the defensive against anti-evolution activists who want biblical stories to be taught as fact. In fact, the first wave of legal fights against evolution was supported by the Klan in the 1920s. Ever since then, entrenched racism and the ban on teaching evolution in the schools have gone hand in hand. In his piece, What We Get Wrong About the Evolution Debate, Adam Shapiro argues that the history of American controversies over evolution has long been entangled with the history of American educational racism. This person probably has no idea that actually evolutionary science is the strongest weapon against her ideology, and this is the part where I want to bring up the education system. They simply do not educate students on these topics, but I'll save this for part 2. But in any event, this is how the lie that BIPOCs are being systemically discriminated against is reproduced. It's on the back of whites being structurally discriminated against, especially by the media. It's the sheer abundance of media resources being driven back on us in the form of a giant leftist narrative which silences all the counter-narratives, not just through censorship, but also through the sheer amount of its volume and reach of their microphone, which overwhelms the target. This is why instead of talking about structural racism being done against white people, conservatives argue that there is no systemic racism in the country. And this is how we started to believe in the myth of white privilege, that whites are racist, anti-Asian hate crimes are because of white people, that blacks are oppressed, that the ex-president of the United States is a Russian agent, and that inflation doesn't exist, or if it exists that's a good thing, and a bunch of other stuff that has been ingrained in us in the past years. So notice how I haven't even spoken about how ridiculous is the American coverage of the foreign affairs, how it privileges certain narratives over others, even when it covers certain countries that are proven to be running as openly supremacist, engaging in war crimes, political imprisonment, and Lebensraum policy, while rejecting the modern American values of group equality, the media still portrays them to be in the right. And boy, there's just so much about foreign coverage that it's wrong, but we don't have to get there for now. In case if you need a clear mechanism of how this is happening, here I will propose a clear model. To get a better perspective, I even have read Noam Chomsky's Manufacturing of Consent, but it turned out to be a shit book, to be honest. I couldn't finish it. Chomsky's reasoning can probably explain only the Hunter Biden laptop story, but it fails at describing most of what I'm talking about. Why? Because he comes at it from a bi-socialist perspective, and obviously his model doesn't seem to explain much of the variance, as it's mostly culturally loaded. The reality is much easier to explain with understanding of the supply mechanisms. In 1962, 57% of Washington correspondents had described themselves to be liberal, while 28% had described themselves to be conservative. In 1961, the media was just about 30% more Democrat than Republican, but in 2013, the media was 400% more Democrat than Republican. Moreover, in a 2004 Pew Research publication, it was found out that although 7% of the national news journalists are conservative, despite conservatives making up of at least 33% of the public, which is to say that the representation of the conservative beliefs barely exists in the media. In 2002, 58% of the public had believed that a belief in God is necessary to be moral, while only 6% of the national press thought so. In fact, a large majority of conservative journalists believe that it is not necessarily to believe in God in order to be moral, despite this being the conservative and the majority position, and they as conservatives failed to provide a conservative voice. Similarly, just 5% of the national press expressed a belief that a society ought to discourage homosexuality, while about 42% of the public believed so. That is to say, even if there is a percentage message in the media that calls itself conservative, they are likely conservative only when it comes to conserving the plight of the poor and dysregulating the economy to a point of a national turmoil. When it comes to holding actual conservative beliefs, if they went to Harvard, forget about it. A recent paper by David Rosato and Masa Al-Gharbi explored the relationship of ideological bias with over 27 million news and opinion articles and found out by the way that words were used, even centrist journalists had a left-wing bias, with overall ideological bias to be at around 0.7, which is pretty high. Finally, in a paper titled "The Left Liberal Skew of Western Media," Emil Kierkegaard et al. Have recently conducted a large study which had attempted to understand to what degree is the public underrepresented by the media industrial complex and why the media is so biased in the first place. Instead of focusing on those who own the media, as previous studies found it had little effect than expected, or looking at individual beliefs, they have looked at journalists and their voting behavior. It was found out that those on the political left were overrepresented by at least 2 times among the journalists, while those whose ideology was national conservatism, for example nationalism, libertarianism, populism, were all highly underrepresented relative to their population size, with some cases being more than 20 times. To quote the study, in some cases, the magnitude of journalists' relative preference was quite large. Across the two variations of RR, the general population votes about 6.1 times more for national conservative parties as journalists do, whereas journalists vote about 3 times more for green parties. However, this study overrepresented right-wing attitudes among journalism, given most of the data came from Eastern and Southern Europe, which is as diverse as journalists were in the mid-20th century the United States, so the actual bias skews way worse than it is depicted here. However, the study is incredibly useful as it provides a universalist model for media bias that is far superior to Noam Chomsky model expressed in the manufacturing of consent. Anyhow, there are 3 fundamental things that exist universally and are causing the media to be biased, and if you have been paying very close attention previously, I have alluded to the general picture of it. Let me quote you this study. By and large, journalists seek out stories in the information stream that surrounds them, which happens to include a lot of other journalists. This is known as gatekeeping, culminating in an echo chamber and a selection of stories. The journalists essentially choose the stories which already surround them. For example, if I were to talk about Saudi Arabia while living in Saudi Arabia, then most of the news will talk about the international diplomacy, trade deals, the royal family, the construction of cities, Dubai, and Islam. However, in our Ivy League produced journalism, the first thing that comes to their mind is stories about cuckolding, polyamory, coverage on the intolerance towards immigrants, diversity good, climate change, feminism, COVID, and etc. Second, journalists pick the sources which better suit their narrative, and I quote, "On some occasions, journalists may seek out particularly ill-informed members of the opposing side of the story as to make the other side look bad." Now, this doesn't just count misquoting someone or cutting them right in the middle of the sentence as they did with Trump. It is also about inviting certain people and not inviting others, citing certain organizations while not citing other organizations or mislabeling them. For example, Fox News is engaging in this time to time by inviting fake experts who think that climate change is not human-driven. Similarly, you'll never see any white nationalists present at a discussion about white people. They are strategically kept out of the discussion by our media. Third, the journalists have the power of framing. How should a given individual be introduced or labeled as? Consider Charles Murray, the author of the controversial book The Bell Curve, which is about intelligence and social inequality in the United States. Should he be described as far right? controversial or a pseudoscientist. These are certainly labels that have been used for him, or maybe he should be described as a scholar associated with the American Enterprise Institute, which emphasizes his political association with the libertarian-leaning think tank, or even as a leading scholar of American inequality, which emphasizes his intellectual contributions. Similarly, you can ask yourself, if the media was to be biased in our way, could we maybe present Jared Diamond as a discredited pseudo-historian? Could we maybe present the BLM as a domestic terrorist Marxist organization? With the right power distribution in the media, we could. Similarly, as the media of the first economy of the world presents the values of liberalism in the negative light. Finally, there is also a meta variable that influences all these variables combined that I came up with by reading Jonathan Haidt and Mencius Moldbug. The general consensus embedded in the cathedral is essentially underpinned by the moral foundations and beliefs of these who pass the information down to us. Which is to say that cultural biases are the primary driver of all these biases identified by Emil Kierkegaard et al. In our case, the cultural biases are the leftist vision of our society, which serves as a filter of all incoming information, sorting it out, what should be said and what shouldn't be said, just the way Walter Lippmann had designed it. Either way, my basic argument is that this is not a planned operation or a conspiracy, but rather an organic development that had resulted from having people of a one socio-political culture running the show. The Soviet Union was governed similarly, now China is being governed similarly. Hell, Russia, Israel, and a ton of other countries have a media system which corresponds to the interests of their local elites and their particular consensus of where society should be going towards. The Russian elites engineer consent and the public seems to buy it, as there are only two liberal journalists in the top 10 most ranked journalists in Russia. Similarly, how in the United States the Democrats are most trusting of the media. In Russia, it is those who are shaped by the class which rules over them, similarly as here. The media in Russia is not left-wing at all, and consequently is the Russian public, which is shaped by the same media. Only Russian younger generation is immune against this propaganda because they don't happen to watch the TV. Similarly, the effects of Israeli media had in part created the most right-wing generation perhaps in the entire world, but certainly in the developed world. Now, this is the true most conservative generation ever, not the stupid hope that Tim Pool and Steven Crowder is trying to sell you, and that is all because people are sheep and are governed by the type of information they consume, and if somebody has a monopoly on supply, well, you're going to consume only one thing and form your opinions according to whatever you are consuming. This is why like 99% of Afghanistan is Muslim. The distortion of reality and bias is simply a side effect that happens when around 90% of the journalists belong to a particular socio-cultural category and nobody is there to challenge it. Anyways, the last thing I want to address today is that there's also this conservative cope that apparently the media is not trusted or whatever. Yes, it's not trusted among Republicans, which is no surprise, but the Democrats are very trustful of the media, and no surprise again, given it basically works to reaffirm their beliefs. And at the end of the day, it's more important that the Democrats trust it, because they happen to be running the show. The media can function well, even with 0% independent and Republican support. It only matters that the governing class and its minions support it, and they do. Either way, that's all I wanted to say for today. Thank you for watching, and stay tuned for more episodes about how institutions shape society.